In this unit and next unit, we are going to deal with film history. I divided the film history sessions into two parts. So the first part for this week, we're going to talk about American cinema, history of American cinema. And next week is going to be dedicated, the next lecture, to world cinema. Talking about the actual history of American cinema, I just want to talk about four different approaches, theoretically, four different approaches to film history. The aesthetic, the technological, the economic, and the social history approach. All these things, these approaches are not actually distinct. They overlap, and something that starts as a technological chain, definitely has impacts on both economical and aesthetic approaches to film history. For example, a couple of weeks ago, if you remember, we talked about sound, the transition to sound in the late 20s. It happened mainly for commercial reasons. So there was a social change because there was a change in the habits and habits of the moviegoers and the type of moviegoers, different maybe classes, and they were expecting different sorts of entertainments. And so for that, what was needed was the technological infrastructure. So there was also a technological shift in the late 20s with the transition to sound. But immediately, that transition had an impact on film style. So you can also discuss that transition from aesthetic point of view. Shot lengths were increased significantly, average shot length. There was also a change in acting. You wouldn't see male actors crying on the set anymore after the transition to sound. Also less camera movements. So these are all so more aesthetic shots. So these are all sort of changes that started as economical and technological, but had an impact in so definitely on film style. Another example, you might know that in traditional Japanese dining, usually there's a small table that they place it on the floor. And they just sit on the floor and eat. So maybe there was a cultural reasons in the films of Ozu, a Japanese filmmaker, to place the camera in a low position but straight. So something that is not known as kids' point of view. However, Japanese films in modern settings and European and American films, inspired by the films of Ozu, they started to borrow that stylistic element strictly for aesthetic reasons. There was no cultural reasons, definitely, when you film a scene in North America. So if you remember, there were a number of shots like that in the films of Wes Anderson's that we dealt in this class. So there are a number of other things. So in, for instance, Germany, the idea was that they had this sort of half sets. And so like the studio's setting were not sort of suitable for things like shot reverse shot because the crews were on one side. So when in the 30s, with the rise of National Socialism in Germany, a number of German filmmakers and cinematographers immigrated to the United States, and they carried that style. So instead of shot reverse shot, they were using zoom in and zoom out, just because they thought that it was, you know, it was something that they knew. So it just it became again some sort of aesthetic signature of Hollywood movies in the late 30s and 40s. we're talking about American cinema, I just want to let you know, and I'm going to come back to that issue, that American cinema was always international. It's not restrictly in national cinema. And I'm going to give the examples why I would make such claim. American cinema usually is known as a narrative cinema, that all stylistic elements are there to prompt the narrative. So we have invisible editing and even other aspects of cinematography, all for a progression of a linear narrative. However, it was not always like that. So before 1913, American cinema was not really a narrative cinema. Even when there was a narrative, there were very sort of simple narratives, simple stories, and like things that people knew the stories. So it was really the cinema of spectacle. A kind of cinema that invited its spectators to experience a state of shock. Like Edison has this shocking, for instance, film of electrifying of an elephant. So this cinema was known as cinema of attraction by film theorist Tom Gunning. For that time, it was the cinema of special effects, photographic superimpositions. There was actually kind of frequent look at the camera by the actors. I remember this scene from Great Train Robbery, when shooting at the camera. So there was this sort of issues of theatricality, the staging of the actor. So it was really the cinema for its shock effects and aesthetic strategies, not really a narrative cinema at all. So it was a cinema that displays its visibility and it's always to solicit the attentions of the spectators. What we have from 1917 is the beginning of classical Hollywood cinema. And I said 1917 because film historian Kristen Thompson claimed that the beginning of classical Hollywood cinema is 1917. So it started in 1917, and she argues that it ended in the mid-50s. However, some sort of the tendency towards more narrative films started from 1913 with the films of D.W. Griffith, the most important figure in that era. So what is a classical cinema? Classical Hollywood cinema. So we actually, in this class, we watch a couple of films that can be categorized as classical Hollywood. So there are very important conventions. Notable ones are invisible editing or continuity editing. So no jump cuts or any sort of manipulation of time and space. So editing is just something, it is used only to serve the narrational goal of the film. It's a narrative-based cinema, reliance on star system. Division of labor, that means like we have a casting directors, we have the directors, and so usually the director doesn't have a voice or authority for all these stages of production. So it's just you have to make a movie based on this novel, and these are going to be your actors. And after the filming, directors sometimes were not even present in the editing room. So it's different than European art cinema of that time, that the filmmakers had the absolute authority in all the stages of the film production. Usually a causal, a linear narrative is used in classical Hollywood films. And events usually are motivated. Usually known for happy ending, and again, Again, the most important element is continuity. However, a classical Hollywood cinema is also divided into maybe three phases. So the origins of the classical Hollywood cinema during the silent era started with the movie Birth of a Nation by D.W. Griffith. And all conventions of classical Hollywood cinema are used in the movie The Birth of a Nation. The continuity editing, cross-cutting, sort of cause and effect logic for narrative. Restrictly using or respecting 180 degree rules and so on. So this is an important film. It's just marked the beginning of narrative cinema, the classical Hollywood narrative cinema. It's also an important film because it was extremely racist. Where the Ku Klux Klans were shown as the savior of modern America, restoring law and order. So if you've seen the last Spike Lee film, it's Black Klansman, something like that. It's difficult to actually read the title. But if you've seen that movie, it just actually created connections with this film and today's politics, what happened in the last few years in Virginia, Missouri, Detroit. It's an important film in shaping the minds of people. And remember, I was talking about social historical approach. So regardless of its stylistic innovation, it just it had a key role in certain things that was happening at that time. The KKK's membership significantly raised after the release of these films in North America. So for a decade, like from a few thousands, it just became like hundreds of thousands, and then kind of significantly dropped a decade after, and today probably there are less than 1,000 people. All this is, it's important film, both politically and stylistically, obviously. So and the scenes that I'm showing on the right side is actually from his other film, Broken Blossom. And it's just, he made it as an apology for the previous one, like saying that I'm not a racist one. And it's just, he made this film as an apology. Probably if we look at this film with today's standards, we will find it even more racist than the previous ones. But again, as you're going to see, look at the scene, the use of sort of 180 degree rules and continuity and visible editing in that scene. Transition to sound also significantly changed certain elements of classical Hollywood cinema. The first film is actually Jazz Singer. That was released in 1927. And as I said, there were more sort of realistic actings from now on. But one thing that is happening after the transition to sound, specifically in the mid-30s and in the 40s, is the influence of German Expressionism. And that's the thing that I said. It's a cinema that always were... always have been international. And so with the rise of National Socialism in Europe, a number of filmmakers, because of their Jewish background or because they just had problems with the politics in Germany, like Fritz Lang, Ernest Lubitsch, other figures, Michael Curtiz. Douglas Sirk. They couldn't work anymore in Central Europe, they moved to Hollywood. And what we have in Hollywood films of that era, film noir, is synthesis of classical Hollywood style and German Expressionism. In terms of the content and performances, we had this realistic tendency towards social problem films in the post-war American cinema. But they use certain visual elements of German expressionist cinema, a formalist approach to lighting, for example. The most important element that you can see that is definitely influenced by German expressionism is the use of lighting in those films. That's very unrealistic, very formalist use of usually low-key lighting. Hollywood, classical Hollywood cinema, can also be divided into two eras with regards to censorship. So there were early films before, like mid-30s, that, like you see an image on your right side, two characters in a bed, and one of them is smoking, a female character is smoking. Certain these things were not permitted after the introduction of the codes. So before what we know as Hays Code, there were more freedom in Hollywood cinema. But these codes started to be seriously enforced after 1934. The whole idea is to maintain the moral standards of, the so-called moral standards of the society. So, for example, again, female characters couldn't smoke. If husband and wife were shown in a bed, they couldn't be shown in the same bed. So sometimes you see actually there are two beds in the bedroom. Or if they're in one bed, each character should have at least 1 foot on the floor. Love affair between different races, such as black and white characters, were not permitted, or at least it shouldn't be shown as successful. It should be shown not in a happy ending way. So even if there were sort of suggestion of so-called colored love, it should have been doomed. So this actually went on, and in the 50s, these issues kind of were even more heavily introduced in American films, and it's just for some of it because of the McCarthy's witch hunt in the 50s. So a number of people in the United States of America were lost their jobs because of little suggestion that they worked or they had some sort of connections with the Communist Party. And some of them, again, the people who were married, because there were some sort of suggestions that they were homosexual, for example, and people lost their jobs. And Hollywood was also kind of affected by that witch hunting. People actually started to lose their jobs. Some people were forced to name the names of other producer, director, cinematographer, screenwriter. The 50s, you see sort of a strong censorship imposed on American films. So there were actually a number of things per person who were behind that sort of restrict codes in the 50s was actually an anti-Semite. So this ended in 1960s, and with the release of the film Spartacus, that was kind of using the script written by one of the people in that sort of blacklist Hollywood. Remember our basic approaches. So in the 60s, the end of classical Hollywood era, and we have a new era known as New Hollywood Cinema. For different reasons, we can talk about that transition. So definitely there is a social history approach. The new generations didn't like to go and see these coded Hollywood films. there was a countercultural movements happening in the 60s. So there were actually smaller movie theaters in New York City showing European films. For more nudities, more intellectual films, and for maybe both reasons, actually, the younger audiences, we're going to see those foreign films. So those sort of coded Hollywood films are not appealing to younger generations. There was also some economical reasons, because television was introduced. And the studios were sort of competing with another medium. And they needed to lift up that restriction, otherwise they were not going to survive. So for older people, specifically, they were staying home and were watching TV. And as I said, younger people were not interested in Hollywood films or classical Hollywood films anymore. So now, in terms of the aesthetic approach, there were a number of filmmakers, new Hollywood film, a generation of Hollywood filmmakers, who attended film schools. People like Martin Scorsese, for example, Hal Ashby, Francis Ford Coppola. All these people, they studied film in film schools, and they were familiar with European films, with the history of cinema, so they just didn't want to work only with the conventions of Hollywood cinema. Another thing, as I said, that American cinema was always international. We have this phase of immigration to Hollywood, and this time from the 60s and 70s from Eastern Europe, after certain things that happened in countries like Poland, Czechoslovakia. A more sort of restrict censorships started after the invasion of Prague, for example, by the Soviet army. Again, more censorship rules were imposed on the filmmakers and writers and the artists. So they also started to immigrate to Hollywood. Miloš Forman, actually a Czech filmmaker, made actually two movies that won Best Pictures. One was Amadeus, and the other one, One Fly Over Cuckoo's Nest. Also, he made movies like Hair. Another figure is Roman Polanski, who stayed for a kind of short period of time in the United States, but his films had a significant impact on the film industry in the United States. So the new American cinema, as I said, television made older audiences stay home. There's a French New Wave influence and underground cinema started to appear, and film became some sort of an art form. So there were colleges and universities. So to show the influence of French New Wave on American cinema, I'm showing a scene from a French New Wave movie, Two or Three Things I Know About Her by Jean-Luc Godard. And then the next scene is a similar scene from Taxi Driver, that definitely you're going to see the inspiration.
One. I know Phil can get you a real nice deal. Lots of shit around.
I never use mine. I'm conservative, you know? But it's a good thing to have just as a threat.
Well, I'm gonna go do my dirt.
So the new American cinema is not really a counter-narrative cinema. It's different than French New Wave. You see the influence, but it's still, in terms of the fact that it's a character-based and a narrative-based cinema, is it still following the Hollywood conventions? It added more ambiguity and uncertainty to that narrative cinema. So in the two scenes that I showed, the first one by Jean-Luc Godard, it has nothing to do with really the characters, and you hear the voiceover of Jean-Luc Godard. It seems that he's just giving us some information about the divorce politics and the universe at that time. The second scene from Taxi Driver, that scene is still emblematics of the psychic state of the characters. The mental impulses of the character is shown in that sort of scene. So still, even a scene like that, still kind of, you can say, is very much character-driven. And these are the characteristics of the movement. So not anymore we have happy endings or controversial themes, for example, the subjectivity of the protagonist. So I'm going to show you another scene. It was an era of countercultural movements, hippies. Young people are biking from one side of the country to the other. There's also a sympathy for criminals in these films, and that adds to the controversy. Let's see the next scene from Easy Rider.
Down his head.
And I like his eyes.
What the hell is this? Troublemakers? You name it, I'll throw rocks at it, Sheriff.
Y'all, check what just walked in. Ooh, I like the one in the red shirt with the suspenders.
The white shirt's for me.
Yeah,
look how stuffy black pants are. I understand. Now, what did you say?
I said,
Bloom
Tang.
What?
I said, Bloom Tang, yeah.
Oh, I just can't believe. What are they doing here? Look at the teeth are on his neck.
Oh.
Do they drive up on motorcycles?
They know we're talking about them. What's going on here?
Hot bam. Tell you. I think I'll order kidneys because I left mine out there on the road somewhere.
I don't know, but I like his tail when he's got on his head.
And I like his eyes.
Girl right over there in the corner. Well, don't look too close at her because the sheriff's right over there, you know what I mean?
Check that joker with the long hair.
I've checked him already. Looks like we might have to bring him up to the Hilton before it's all over.
I think she's cute.
Isn't she, though? I guess we put them in a woman's cell, don't you reckon?
Oh, I think we ought to put them in a cage and charge a little admission to see them.
Those are what are known as country witticisms.
I can't believe they're here. What are they doing here?
I don't know.
No, we can't ask. We don't be foolish.
Yeah.
No, they'll think you're cold. You'll laugh in your face.
Yeah, I'd be good.
I doubt it.
I might.
You might. Go ahead.
Not when I'm around, you're not going to ask me.
I don't think so.
Go ahead.
Okay.
You know, I thought at first that bunch over there, the mothers, had maybe been frightened by a bunch of gorillas, but now I think they were caught.
Oh, one of them's alley-oop, I think. Some of the bees on them.
Well, one of them darn sure is not Ula. Looked like a bunch of refugees from a gorilla love-in.
A gorilla couldn't love that.
Knock it a mother.
I made him up in one of those black wenches out there.
Oh, no, I don't know about that.
And that's about as low as they come. I'll tell you.
Oh, he's a biggie.
And they're green.
No, they're not green. They're white.
White?
Uh-huh.
And you're colorblind. I just got to say that.
I'd sure like to get some food around there.
I don't know. I thought most jails were built for humanity, and that won't quite qualify.
Wonder where they got those wigs from.
They probably grew them, look like they're standing in fertilizer. Nothing else would grow on them.
No, you know, I'm not real hungry at the moment.
You know what I mean?
I saw two of them one time. They were just kissing away. Two males. Just think of it.
What you think we ought to do with them?
I don't never know, but I don't think they'll make the parish line.
Let's play.
What?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
It certainly has been nice.
They got some fancy bikes out there. That's some Yankee Quiz. Check the flag on that bike.
Sure is.
I still say they're not going to make the parish line.
Hey, Scout, can I have a ride?
You want a ride?
Yeah.
You got a note for your mom?
The man is at the window. So what you saw in that clip, the conflict between the generations, the idea of countercultural movements, when these figures are coming into this small conservative American town. The cinema of Woody Allen is an important one for that period of American cinema. Woody Allen promoted certain aspects of countercultural movements, but it was against some other aspects of it. So in this scene in Annie Hall, you're going to see his references to certain aspects of countercultural movements at that time. The appearances of the central female character in a romantic comedy that refuses to wear a traditional feminine dress, and the sort of usual gender binaries of classic romantic comedies in Hollywood cinema were broken between the two. The independence of the central female character, for example. Also, you see a reference to foreign films, and it's something you see always in Woody Allen films of that time. So again, they are in this movie theater, probably these, as I said, small movie theaters in New York, show a screening foreign films often. And that scene, actually, he wanted to bring in Federico Fellini for that scene, but it actually didn't happen. But you see the references to Fellini. You're going to see the references to Fellini.
Piece of structure, you know, you get the feeling that he's not absolutely sure what it is he wants to say. Of course, I've always felt he was essentially a technical filmmaker. Granted, La Strada was a great film. Great in its use of negative imagery more than anything else. But that central cohesive core, you know, that must lead through an artist's work, leading from one to the other.
Screaming his opinions in my ear.
You understand what I'm talking about? Like all that Juliet of the Spirits or Satyricon, I found it incredibly indulgent. You know, he really is. He's one of the most indulgent filmmakers. He really is.
Keyword
and without getting, let's put it this way.
What are you depressed
about?
I miss my therapy. I overslept.
Okay. How can you possibly oversleep?
The alarm clock.
Do you know the hostile gesture that is to me?
I know, because of our sexual problem, right?
Everybody online at the New Yorker has to know our rate of intercourse.
It's like Samuel Beckett. Now, I admire the technique, but it doesn't hit me on a gut level.
I'd like to hit this guy on a gut level.
Stop it, Albie.
He's spitting on my neck. You know, he's spitting on my neck.
The most important thing of all,
and you know something else? You know, you're so egocentric that if I miss my therapy, you can only think of it in terms of how it affects you.
It's Weltanschauung is what it is.
Probably on their
it's
first date, right?
View
probably met by answering an ad in the New York Review of Books. 30-ish academic wishes to meet woman who's interested in Mozart, James Joyce, and sodomy. What do you mean our sexual problem? I mean, I'm comparatively normal for a guy raised in Brooklyn.
Okay, I'm very sorry. My sexual problem. Okay, my sexual problem, huh?
I never read that. That was Henry James, right? Novel?
You know
the sequel to Turn of the Screw?
It's the influence of television.
Another thing that you see in the films of Woody Allen at that time is popularizing the idea of psychoanalysis, a clinical practice, more for elite class that started in Germany and Austria and later in France. But it was at that time in New York City that actually Woody Allen had an important role in popularizing it in his films.
Yeah, now, Marshall McLuhan deals with it in terms of it being a high intensity, you understand? A hot medium.
What I wouldn't give for a large sock with horse manure in it. What do you do when you get stuck on a movie line with a guy like this behind you?
Wait a minute, why can't I give my opinion? This is a free country?
He can give you. Do you have to give it so loud? I mean, aren't you ashamed to pontificate like that? And the funny part of it is, Marshall McLuhan, you don't know anything about Marshall McLuhan's work.
Really? I happen to teach a class at Columbia called TV, Media, and Culture. So I think that my insights into Mr. McLuhan, well, have a great deal of validity.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Well, that's funny, because I happen to have Mr. McLuhan right here. So yeah, just let me come over here a second.
Oh, I heard what you were saying. You know nothing of my work. You mean my whole fallacy is wrong. How you ever got to teach a course in anything is totally amazing.
Boy, if life were only like this.
Another thing, so you see in that scene, is breaking the fourth wall, direct address by the actor. So it's something, again, that was not permitted in classical Hollywood cinema. It's something that, again, Woody Allen and some other filmmakers at that time started to borrow from European cinema, the Brechtian technique of breaking the fourth wall. So, however, Woody Allen was against certain aspects of countercultural movements at that time. He actually remained anti-drug and anti-rock and roll.
It's really killing me.
Albie,
you know,
listen, while you're in California, could you possibly score some coke for me?
Sure, I'd be glad to. I'll just put it in a hollow heel that I have on my boot. You know? How much is this stuff in sound?
It's about $2,000 an ounce.
God.
Really?
And so
what is the kick of it? Which I never...
Walk into your groove. I don't want to be different, so I'm going to be just like you. Because I go by records and they play on the radio. I'm gonna dance that club's gonna do just what I'm told.
Why are you making those faces?
I can't hear you. I can't hear anything. I'm gonna lose hearing in my ear.
Listen, you're witnessing genius.
My ears are experiencing a meltdown. I can't feel anything.
Can't you feel the energy? Tangible energy. The room's alive with positive vibrations.
I'm frightened. I'm after they sick. They're gonna take hostages. Let's don't. No, please. You
want some?
No.
Come on, Nick.
No, you've been doing that all night. You're gonna burn a hole. And you're gonna develop a third nostril.
I want
to dress
up.
No, please.
Sure,
can we go?
No. I love songs about extraterrestrial life, don't you?
Not when they're sung by extraterrestrials.
Oh, well, I cannot communicate with you. I never realized you were such a tight ass.
I don't understand you. Your sisters, both sisters, have such good taste in music. I don't know where you went wrong.
Do you mind? I'm my own person.
From the 80s, we can trace the beginning of a new era known as blockbuster, that maybe we are still in it with all the cineplexes and the idea of franchise films. All the blockbuster stores are closed now because of the transition to the digital cinema. But so this cinema is known as a mainstream cinema. The idea of franchise with like Superman, Supergirl, all those things were kind of prominent. It was a highly commercialized cinema and usually targeting the teenage audiences. And we're using comics, maybe again because those comic books were popular among the teenage audiences. Science fiction films that were taking place in suburban areas like E.T. action films with strong masculine character at the center. And reliance on special effects, these were important characteristics of blockbuster cinema. The next era that I want to talk is American independent cinema, and it started from the 90s. In this cinema, again, we have more controversial topics focusing on marginalized group, LGBT movements, racial minorities, more ambiguous narrative, less genre films, more realism, and again, the possibility of making films with a low budget helped many younger independent filmmakers to be recognized because of this shift in making more independent films. So that's why from the 90s on we have more women filmmakers, and that one reason, because it was easier to finance their movies with the smaller producers. It wouldn't have to be like Harvey Weinstein anymore. Still, there are less than 17% of American films made by women, but you see that if in comparison with the periods before digital cinema, there are definitely more women filmmakers, also African-American filmmakers, and films dealing with LGBT themes. You can see the recognition of these films by more mainstream audiences and even more mainstream film festivals. Even Academy Awards were usually known for giving their awards to high-budget films such as Titanic. In the last two decades, however, you see among Oscar nominees more independent films, such as Moonlight, or even the movie that won last year, Parasite, that were not actually very high budget, or they were not part of a very mainstream cinema. So in this slide, you see two films done by a young female artist, Anna Lily Amanpour. Just before giving you an example of that independent cinema, with regards to what I said about international aspects of cinema, so we had in the post-war Hollywood cinema, we see the influence of German expressionism, and in the 60s, Eastern European directors like Milos Forman and Polanski immigrated to the United States. We see in the last couple of decades the influence of Asian cinema, East Asian cinemas. So filmmakers like Tarantino just started to use the aesthetic of Asian martial art films. But also we see actually a movie like Parasite won the Oscar, and actually people started to pay attention to South Korean films. And a movie about two gay Americans in the 60s was made by a Chinese director. He was invited to make this film in Hollywood, Ang Lee. So you see actually some sort of attention with regards to the aesthetic of East Asian cinema. So the last scene that I want to show is from Moonlight. And again, it's a kind of a movie that is about marginalized group. It won the Best Picture. It actually, the last scene is different than the typical classical Hollywood cinema with some sort of happy ending and some sort of a closure. It actually is a scene that is similar to a scene by French New Wave movie 400 Blows.
And it's ever touched me. The only one. touched anyone since.
So just before finishing this unit, I want to say that all these periods that I talked about, they were not, it's not that other types of films were not being made in that period. So when I talked about pre-cinema, early years, with regards to cinema of attraction, it never really faded out. In Hollywood, so there was a little bit of cinema of attraction all the time, and it's still in mainstream Hollywood films you see cinema of attraction. Think about films like Mad Max. It's not really a narrative film. It's an example. It's about its rhythm, spectacle. It's really a cinema of attraction. We had even franchise film. From like the 30s in American films, you had like Bride of Frankenstein, Son of Frankenstein, Frankenstein, and then the different remakes of Frankenstein's, for example. So there were independent films. Maya Darren, really an interesting artist, was making movies in the 40s, and everything were permitted in her films. But they were not shown in mainstream movie theaters. So when I say like the last two decades, we see the rise of indie films. It's just because there are more chance for publics to view those independent films. So similarly, we still see classical Hollywood films and definitely blockbuster films. So that was a good history of American cinema. So in the next unit, we're going to talk about world cinema, history of world cinema. Thank you.